The community of Union City is nestled in the northeast section of Madison County, approximately 7 miles from the courthouse. Its name derives from a house of worship established in 1812 by two religious bodies. Today, there are two churches in the community, Union City Baptist, established in April 1812, and Union City Christian, established in October 1830. In 1848, the Baptists and Christians erected a brick house of worship to be used by both groups.
This church was established in 1830, and it seemed that the camel and the stone movement had come through, and most of the members of the Baptist church went to that movement. But they stayed on in the same building. The Baptist people, I think, had the services the first Sunday, and the Christian church congregation had theirs the second Sunday. And that's the way it got started.
On November 3rd, 1893, the Christian Church sold its interest in the Union Meeting House to the Baptists for $200. Land was obtained from Madison Fiscal Court, and on May 13th, 1894, the Union City Christian Church was dedicated. Names prominent in the Christian Church at that time were Jett, Turpin, Hamilton, Bonney, Parrish, McKinney, Gentry, Harris, Taylor, and Todd.
Since 1894, this was dedicated, and it's been approximately 150 years that it's been existing, this location. Of course, it was been redecorated and renovated, and it was originally just weatherboarding, and then in later years it was veneered brick, and of course all these additions have been added to it, and improvements.
Well, I'll go on with Alan Anderson. He was a older man. I guess he was in his 30s when he went to Bible college in Atlanta, Georgia. He'd even served a term or a tour in the army. And he wasn't, well, just out of college, and wasn't too much forceful preacher at the time. And I remember Ms. Thomas saying later in years, Ms. Lure Thomas, that when I wondered why in the world those men wanted that man when he came, but said as time went on, so I saw why, that he made a good preacher, a good forceful preacher. And he visited this community. He was in about every home in this community. Just go in and introduce himself and invite the people to church, and it showed up. We had some of the highest attendance I can remember while he was here, and he just a hard worker, and the church really grew from his efforts. Well, Larry had a long ministry also, almost 8 years, and he was very popular and good preacher, and people enjoyed and liked to hear him. He's the fastest talking man anybody about ever heard, but he could say a whole lot in his turn.
Built in 1913, the four-room Union City High School housed students in grades 1 through 12. Generations of families attended until the school closed in 1962. Among those who taught at the school were Cora Dunbar, Annie Sharp, Louisa Rupert, and Nancy Hamilton. Memories of formative school years are cherished today.
Well, my first year was at Union City High School, but they called it Union City Crawfish College because it had crawfish chimneys about that tall all over the schoolyard. If you wasn't careful, you'd fall in.
And I went to school up here at Union. Of course, Miss Cora Dunbar was my teacher. I guess she's been everybody's teacher in Union. And we rode a pony to school.
Down where my daddy lives, to school up here. Ice, sleet, snow. Now, we didn't stay out for sleet and snow like we did that.
You didn't have school buses.
No, I waded the snow up in my legs a minute, ain't you, Francis?
But the boys played basketball, and they go around over the county, you know, play games. We had old dirt court out there. And they changed their clothes before they left, put on their little suits. And I was the ringleader, I guess. And we gathered up all of their clothes, every rag they took off, and put them in a bundle. And we had this old curtain that came down off the stage, you know, that go up and down. And we tied all those clothes up in there and sent them to the top of this building right up here. And you know how tall it is. And then threw the bottom of the rope up there. Then when it was time for them to come back, we had started home. It was time to go home. And we laid over there in a ditch to see if they could find the clothes so they could go home. That was pretty bad.
And I was a gray-hand chew chewing gum. I still am a gray-hand chew chewing gum. And she would make me throw it out. So I thought, well, I'll be real smart. So I put that chewing gum right under there, and next in a few minutes, I chewed the gum. Well, in a few minutes, she said, "Marty Lou, I told you to turn that throw that chewing gum out. Get up here. Wow, wow, wow." She smacked me. I never did chew no more chewing gum.
Getting back to Miss Pickett, she was a good teacher. But see, Margaret Lou and her brother and Gene Parks and Neil Tibbs was always into it, and I wasn't Margaret Lou. And one day that we had a substitute teacher, and she came in, she put your name on the board, she put your brother's name on the board, she put Gene's name on the board, and she put Neil Tibbs' name on the board. Well, she turned around and looked at me and just grinned and wrote my name, and I had not done one thing. And I guess she thought I was fixing to, which I guess I was.
Well, I started teaching at Red House, Kentucky, and I taught first and second grades and home ec all in one time. The home ec class was adjoining the little Wigglers. And in all, I guess I've taught about 38 years. My advice would be to have good nerves to start with. And I enjoyed all of my teaching, though.
I left for study. I moved here in 22. Well, it was lots more people then than it was now, because all the families lived here. And a lot of them had big families. And I raised four children, all good children. I raised them in the good times. Well, I'd say to listen to the parents and stay in the right company, and never take anything from strangers or even a ride or anything. I'd tell them to quit sending so much things across the water when there's as many here needs it as it does across the water.
Anytime I come to Union City, I feel at home, and I just feel like I'm walking in the house anywhere I go down here. Well, I started running. I run in 1964, and I took office in 65. Well, this is 27 years. My term ends next year, which will be 28 years. I feel like one of my main roles is trying to take care of the taxpayers' dollars up there. Well, most of all, I think it is honesty in government. And you see so much of it now that, and from a federal right on down to the state, that people are getting caught for taking bribes and this, that, and other. And I think that's a disgrace to the state of Kentucky. I've run for 27, 8 years now, as I told you. I've never taken a bribe or any donation, of any kind. I have only missed two court meetings in the 27 years that I've been there, and I've never passed on but one issue, And that was when they named the courthouse annex after me. And I thought that I shouldn't vote on that. And I think that that's a pretty good record. And I think honesty in government's really the main thing, and stand up for what you think is right.
When I was a child, it was Union City Cash Store. And of course, it didn't change the name when we got it. They were putting the store contents up for auction. And May was out of a job at that time and needed a job. So I said, she said, I haven't got the money to go into it. And I said, well, we put our money together. We had just got our father died in the fall, we just got settled up with the estate. And I said, we'll put what we got together, what you've got and I got, and we'll see what we can do. And so the day of the auction, it was real funny. I thought we were bidding, John was bidding for us, and John said, that's your bid's next bid, said, you've lost it. And he said, you got to bid again. And May said, we haven't got any more money. And so I said, well, Oscar's got $200. I've got stacked away because we just sold our tobacco. I said, we'll use that. So with the $200, we finally got the store contents, which also gave us the right to rent the store. So we, of course, had a pretty hard go of it for a while, and because we had to restock a lot of things. There wasn't too much stock in the store, but we worked hard at it. One of the big things that always stuck with me, that was, we always had to buy eggs. People would bring in eggs for the big basketfuls, and then we had to take them to the produce house. Finally had to go take them to Lexington. You'd have cases after cases of eggs, and you'd have to take them because they were swapped for other groceries and things that they needed. So I think that stuck with me so much. And then we'd buy chickens, and chickens was always something I dreaded because you had to fool with those chickens and try to take them off. So you imagine what a job that was. And of course, there was good and bad of it though. You had good eggs yourself to use. Most everybody in the community loved to come in and sit down and talk and eat snacks and just reminisce together and have a good time. There was nothing out of the way. It was always just plain old fun. Everybody just laughing, talking, and they enjoyed it. And everybody was welcome. And the store would be full, and we'd be there till 11 or 12 o'clock on Saturday nights. And so it was really just a good time for everybody. A country store is more or less a place for that people enjoy. And I think we have people come in that we haven't seen for years. In fact, I don't even know some of them, and I'll be out there and come in, and they say, what a good time we used to have here, So, that really makes you feel good because they remember you. And, we have drummers that we had a long time ago that came there, and they come back and just seem so glad to see you, and you just feel so good to see them.
You're getting this now? Oh, I was born right over in the hall of this close to my house here. I mean, you're getting what I'm saying now? Well, Clifford Lanner lives, was born over there. I married him at 26 years old. He bought me hay bedding at 16 years old, and I've been hay all my life up, still bedding hay. But there's an old horse bedding, like a sogging mill. Put a horse in and put a barn and light around the circle. I farmed all my life. I've been a farmer ever since I was big enough to drive a tractor. And raised tobacco all my life, still raised it. I come here since about 15, 16 years old, raised tobacco down there on the farm. And I'm still a raised tobacco. That's why I used to work cattle. Helped plow the cattle for the turning plow, and used to fodder with the cattle, produce logs with the cattle. The old cattle. Sometimes the logs had two yoke cattle, put two yoke logs, big logs. It was just awfully bad. That's in the flesh. That is, you couldn't find no work. If you did, nobody had no money to pay you, to a certain extent. You could hire a man for a dollar a day to work for you. I did do it, yeah. Back in the depression, my uncle, Ernest Thomas, lived over here. He had some hogs. I bought my meat hog for 4 cents a pound. And in 32, about the time I bought this farm here, I bought some cattle at the stockyards, some cows for $16, $18 a head. Yes, sir. Back then, things was tough. Yes, sir. I joined the church as about 14 to 15 years old. Baptist Church, up there where we're going now. Well, I feel very much at home here. Yes, sir. Come see me sometime.
I might add that I'm personally thankful for all the contributions of our senior members. When I look out in the congregation and I see the problems of the people and the trials of life, and I see personally as their minister that they have weathered the storm, they have seen the heartaches of the people, then I know as I talk with others and share the beliefs that we have, that they're the post of victory. And it gives me great encouragement to encourage them by saying, look at all of our people, and they've had some rough times, and they have come far. So every Sunday, they are a great inspiration to me.
You lay there fighting for each breath while angels hovered around your bed with open arms like God's own smile. They led you to the light. And what a battle you have won. And now your journey has begun. But to the land where spirits fly. And your soul will never die. So travel lightly in my heart. You and I will never part. And far beyond this world we see, there's a place for you and me. And I thank my lucky star. We had a chance to heal our scars. Now I don't have to hang my head over things I wish I said. Far beyond this world we see, there's a place for you and me. And I thank the moon and stars, we had a chance to heal our scars. Now I don't have to hang my head over things I wish I'd said. I don't have to hide my tears, I don't have to drown my fears, and I don't have to hang my head over things I wish I'd said. No, I don't have to live in dread over things I wish I'd said.